So we are going to start our dissection and Dr. Sunil Tanwar will be demonstrating the cadaveric dissection of the nose and basic anatomy and its clinical applications. What are the steps which required during rhinoplasty? He will demonstrate those also along with the anatomy. Dr. Sunil.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, everyone. First of all, welcome in this 5th Global Rhinoplasty Fellowship Cadaver Dissection Program. And first of all, my heartfelt thanks to Dr. Sudhir Bhandari, sir, Principal SMS Medical College, and Dr. Dheeraj Saxena, Professor and Head of Anatomy Department. Then they provide this cadaver for the academic program. Because without this support, this academic program is not possible. Before to start the dissection, friends, today we share some important thing that the rhinoplasty is a difficult surgery in all of the facial plastic surgery. So there are some important challenging factor for the rhinoplasty. So I think there are three important challenging factors that rhinoplasty make the a complicated surgery. The first factor that the nose have endless anatomical variations. You know, in the same patient, the thickness of the nasal bone is not equal, or the tip have the endless anatomical variations. So these make the rhinoplasty a complicated surgery. Second important factor that make the rhinoplasty is a complicated surgery, that is that this surgery need the form and functions. If you give a very beautiful nose to the surgeon, but if the patient, the functional aspect is not good, then it's very difficult to satisfy the patient. So this surgery need the form and functions. The third important challenging factor, that is when you are doing the rhinoplasty surgery, when you do the surgery, then your result match with the expectation of other mind. So these all three factors make the rhinoplasty surgery is more complicated facial plastic surgery rather than other surgery. So for understanding, nasal anatomy, for the surgical anatomy for the rhinoplasty, we can simplify the rhinoplasty. We can divide the nose pyramid in the three part, the upper third and the mid third and the lower third. So each third of the nose, each third of part of the nose have their own inner framework, like the upper third that have the a pair of the nasal bone and six important its attachment. The mid third of the nose that have the consist by a T-shaped upper lateral cartilage and its associated attachment. Then the lower third that have the lower lateral cartilage, LR cartilage and the caudal septum. So all these inner framework of the nose that have a outer soft tissue envelope that cover the entire this nose pyramid. So the knowledge of this outer soft tissue envelope is important, because this outer soft tissue envelope have important prognosis on the result of the surgery. And this outer soft tissue envelope is also an important part in the rhinoplasty surgery, because this outer soft tissue envelope is associated with some important surgical landmarks, and the blood supply of this outer soft tissue envelope is also important. And after that, the thickness of this soft tissue envelope is also important, because it affects the prognosis of the surgery. So before to discuss the inner framework, we just discuss about the soft tissue envelope. And the first, there are important several surgical landmark that we discuss. So the four important surgical landmark regarding the bony vault. The first, that is the glabella. So glabella is the most prominent point on the forehead that usually fall on the mid of the eyebrow. A very important muscles that arise from the glabella, that is the procerus. So sometimes in the during the when you dissect the nose, then this muscle is cut, and due to the injury of these muscles, the muscle is contract upside and the patient produce a gratian profile. Or in the old age, or in the aging, due to these muscles, the patient develop a horizontal wrinkles in the radix area. And we also measure a important aesthetic angle also, nasofrontal angle from the glabella to nasion and the nasion to the tip defining point. The second important point, that is the radix. So basically is the frontonasal, the distance of the frontonasal suture. So basically radix, yeah. बस नहीं कोई बात नहीं बोल यहाँ से फिर उसको सेट करना बड़ा डिफिकल्ट. सो द रेडिक्स इज द स्टार्टिंग पॉइंट ऑफ द नोज. रेडिक्स इज ए बेसिकली डिस्टेंस. रेडिक्स इज द रूट ऑफ द नोज. सो द डीपेस्ट पॉइंट ऑन दिस रेडिक्स, डीपेस्ट पॉइंट ऑन दिस फ्रंटोनजल सूचर, दैट इज द नेजियोन. सो आइडियली द नेजियोन फॉल ऑन द सुप्रा टार्सल फोल्ड. आइडियली द नेजियोन इज फॉल ऑन द सुप्रा टार्सल फोल्ड एंड 4 to 6 millimeter the posterior to this the glabella, that is the nasion. So nasion, your nasion is the upper limit when you do a transverse osteotomy. Whenever we open the nose, then we later discuss. So this is the importance of the nasion. And then fourth important point, that is the rhinion. So friends, the rhinion, the two thing regarding the rhinion is important, because the rhinion is a osteocartilaginous junction. Junction of the bony and the cartilaginous. So the two important things regarding the rhinion. First, the skin thickness. If you compare the skin thickness on the dorsum, the on the rhinion area, the skin thickness is the thinnest. So whenever you do the dorsum dissection, then you great care during the flap elevations, because if there is injury, then you create the scar. And other important thing, in the rhinion area, we have a very important K area. That is the keystone area. So what is the keystone area? Keystone area is the confluence of the four structure, two bone and the two cartilage. So the confluence of the bone is the nasal bone and the perpendicular plate of the ethmoid and the upper lateral cartilage and the septum. So this is the confluence of the four structure, that is the keystone area. Why the keystone area is important? Because the configuration, the attachment of the keystone area is important, because the attachment on the keystone area is not like this. The attachment of the keystone area, that is like this. The distal part of the nasal bone and the caudal and the upper part of the upper lateral cartilage is overlaps. So this distal part of the nasal bone, that is overlap on the upper part of the upper lateral cartilage. So this overlap is maximum in this central part of the keystone area. This overlap around the 10 millimeter, 9 to 10 millimeter in the center area. But if you go laterally in the peripheral keystone area, then the overlapping is reduced, and that overlapping is around the 5 mm. So this upper lateral cartilage get maximum support from this central keystone area. So whenever you do the rhinoplasty, especially during the osteotomy, then you always maintain the integrity of the keystone area, because once you disturb the keystone area, then it's very difficult to reconstruct, because you have the more chance of the injury of the K area during the medial osteotomy, especially in the crooked nose case. So you always maintain the keystone area. So these all about the bony surgical landmark. Then the other is the mid vault. So this mid vault, that consists by a pair of the T-shaped upper lateral cartilage. So the medial part of the upper lateral cartilage, that attaches with the septal cartilage. So the attachment of this upper lateral cartilage and the septum have a specific configuration. That configuration at the 10 to 15 degree angulations, that is the internal nasal valve area. So whenever you do the dissections, like you remove the hump or you do the middle work back, then you always maintain the integrity, or you recreate after the hump removal this internal nasal valve area. So you always maintain this internal nasal valve area. And the lateral most part of the upper lateral cartilage, this lateral most part of the upper lateral cartilage, that don't have any bony attachment. So this lateral most part of the upper lateral cartilage that attach with the wedge of the bone at the lower end of the piriform aperture. So during osteotomy, sometimes this attachment area, if this bony area is damaged or injured, then what happened? The lateral part of this upper lateral cartilage is medialized. And another important thing, and the same site, the anterior end of the inferior turbinate is also attached. So the both things, when they medialize, then the consequently the patient develop the nasal airway problem. So you always preserve this wedge of the bone where the upper lateral cartilage, lateral attachment and the head of the inferior turbinate, that is the Webster triangle. So you always preserve the Webster triangle area also. So these important surgical landmark regarding the mid vault, then the lower vault. The lower vault, first we learn the four subunit of the lower vault. So this most anteriorly projecting part in the lower vault, that is the tip lobule. And on either side of the tip lobule, this free fibrofatty tissue, that is the ala lobule. And this vertical column-like structure that divide this nose in the two equal nostril, that is the columella part. And the part between the lateral to this columella and the medial to this ala lobule, this is the nostril. So the important surgical landmark regarding the tip lobule, marker dena. So there is two light reflecting area on the tip, that is the tip defining point, So the tip defining point, they indicate the dome defining line. When we open the nose, then we detail even see. So the distance between the tip defining point indicate the width of the tip. And where the tip end on the dorsum or where the dorsum is start, then this is the supratip break. So the supratip break, that is the upper limit of the tip lobule. Why we have the supratip break? Once we open the nose, then we see there is a specific relationship between the anterior septal angle and the dome area, because the dome area is around the 6 to 8 millimeter anterior and 3 to 6 millimeter, 6 to 8 millimeter caudal and 3 to 6 millimeter anterior. So this is the difference in the level of the anterior septal angle and the dome area. Then consequently, we get the supratip break. That is the feminine character. And another, the inferior limit of the tip lobule, that is the infratip break. Infratip break, that is the junction of the columella and the tip lobule. So if we met all these points, then you create a two equilateral symmetrical triangle. So the upper part of this triangle, that is the supratip area, and the lower part, the inferior part of this triangle, that is the infratip lobule. So this is the importance of the anatomy, because whenever you know the normal anatomy, then you can assess about the abnormal anatomy and you can identify what underlying deformity you have. Yeah, definitely. If you can have any questions, then you can ask. So this is the supratip area and this is the infratip area. And on lateral side, this is the ala lobules. So in the ala lobule, the part that connect with the lip and the cheek, that is the ala base area, that is the ala base. And the free margin of this ala, that is the ala margins. This is the ala margins. And curvature of the convexity of this ala margin, that is the ala flaring. So the attachment of this ala superiorly with the tip lobule, that have a supra alar groove. Sometimes when a nose have a, like a nose have the blockage or external nasal wall insufficient, then this supra alar groove is more prominent in that nose. This all about the ala lobule. And then the columella. So this columella have the two part. One is the pillar of the columella and other is the base of the columella. So one is the pillar of the columella and the base of the columella. So it's a very important thing, because the length of this pillar of the columella is just equal the length of this nostril. And usually we use this pillar for the transcolumella incision. And the other important thing, the foot plate area. So the foot plate area, whenever we make the incision, we always open the nodes in the transcolumella incision above the foot plate area. Once we open the nose, then we discuss, because it's a very important tip support mechanisms between this foot plate area and the caudal septum, because the nose have the three important tip support mechanism. One is the size, shape, and resilience of this entire LR cartilage. And second is the attachment of the caudal septum with this foot plate area and the medial crust. So if your incision is below the mid part or in the foot plate area, then you can damage the important tip support mechanism. So our incision always should be above the foot plate area. Then on medial to this columella and the medial to this ala lobule and lateral to this columella, that is the nostril cavity. So the two important thing regarding the nostril cavity, one, and the apex of the nostril, this triangular part, that is the soft triangle. So why we have this soft triangle? Because there is a dome notch. Whenever you open the nose, then we see there is a dome notch. So what is the clinical significance of this area? Because in this area, the skin doesn't have the support. So there is very paucity of the subcutaneous tissue, very dense skin-to-skin approximation. So during the marginal incision, if we injured in this area, then the consequently the patient developed the notch in this area. So great care should be taken whenever you go for the marginal incision in the soft triangle area. So this is the importance of the soft triangle area, because notching in this area, then it's very difficult to correct it. So you always preserve this soft triangle area. And another important thing, that is the this posterior cylindrical area, that is the sill of the nose. This is the sill of the nose. So if you want to reduce the ala base width, this is the ala base width, the distance between the both of the ala facial groove. So this is the distance of the ala base width. So if you want to reduce the ala base width, if you want to reduce the cross-sectional area of this nostril, then you go for the seal excision. And if you want to reduce the ala flowering, then you go for the ala base excision. This is the importance of the anatomy. First, you assess about the deformity in which part. Otherwise, if you don't know then which part of the deformity, then it's very difficult to reconstruct this. So these are the important surgical landmark regarding this soft tissue envelope. Then the second part regarding the soft tissue envelope, the blood supply of this soft tissue envelope. So the blood supply of the soft tissue envelopes come from the two system. One is ophthalmic system and another is the facial artery system. So from the ophthalmic system, the dorsal nasal artery is the terminal branch of the ophthalmic system, ophthalmic artery. So that run from the medial part of the orbit and a medial canthus area and run off the dorsum. So in supply the upper part of the nose. And another artery from the facial artery system, that is the superior labial artery, that at the angle of the mouth, superior labial artery, this superior labial artery, so this superior labial artery that run over the lower part of the lip, and this superior labial artery gives some branches in this columella area, that is the columellar branches. Whenever we open the nose, then you always some bleed during the transcolumella incision, that is the columellar branches of the superior labial artery. Okay, and the another important branch of the facial artery systems at that is the angular artery. So this facial artery system have the two branches. One is the angular artery and another is the superior labial artery. This angular artery at the level of the ala base gives some branches that are the lateral nasal arteries. That is the lateral nasal arteries. So these lateral nasal artery, that branches of the angular arteries and branches of some from this dorsal nasal artery have some anastomosis. So that is the subdermal plexus in the smash layer. So this is the blood supply of the nose. And another important thing that some branches of the lateral nasal arteries and the columellar vessels have the anastomosis, that is the LR arcades. So this is the blood supply of the nose. But what is the importance of this blood supply? The importance of the blood supply during the filler injections. You know, this is the example of anastomosis between the external carotid and internal carotid artery, because this facial artery system from the external carotid, but the dorsal nasal artery, that is from the internal carotid artery. So during the filler injection, sometimes what happened when you inject in the wrong plane, then there is a retrograde embolization of the filler through this dorsal nasal artery, through the anterior and posterior ethmoidal artery. Ultimately, the filler enter in the central artery of the retina. And in the study, there is a 38 case blindness reported still. So, you know what exact, when you inject the filler, then you should know then what exact the depth of plane, and you use like a wide-bore needle, and there is so many other important thing, and you have to know about the protocol how you manage. So this is the importance of the blood supply of the nose. And another important thing, you know, when in open rhinoplasty, when we made the transcolumellar incision, then we injured the columellar vessels. So the entire blood supply of the tip is now dependent on the lateral nasal artery, that is branches of the angular artery. So whenever you go for the LFS excision, that your incision not beyond the more than 2 millimeter outside this LF facial junction, because you have the more chance of the injury of the lateral nasal artery. So if you know the anatomical knowledge of the blood supply, then you can preserve the blood supply of the tip. So after this blood supply, these all about the blood supply and this importance. The third important thing, the thickness of the soft tissue envelope, because the thickness of the this soft tissue envelope that ultimately affect the prognosis about the surgery. In Asian patients, we have a thick skin patients. So whenever the patient have a thick skin, if we compare the skin thickness on the dorsum of the nose, then in this nasofrontal area, the skin is thickest. And in the mid vault, the skin is thinnest. And in the tip area, the skin is highly variable due to the sebaceous content in the this skin. So whenever a patient have a thick skin, then definitely we have the certain advantage. What advantage we have? The graft material are better tolerate when a patient have a thick skin, and the graft material is not visible after the surgery. But on the other hand, we have some disadvantage that we need a lot of work to change the appearance of the nose. And in spite of a lot of work and lot of graft, then we don't have any good definitions. So this is the advantage and disadvantage of the thick skin. But on the other hand, we have the thin skin. Then after the surgery, the patient develops some contour irregularities. So the skin thickness, the soft tissue envelope thickness, because in this nose is soft tissue envelope, the composition of the soft tissue envelope is below this skin, there is subcutaneous tissues. So the subcutaneous tissues that have the four layer. First layer, the superficial panniculus layer, and the smears, and the deep fatty layer, and the pericondium, and the periosteum. So the superficial fatty layer, that superficial fatty layer have some fibrous septa. So the fibrous septa connect with the smears layer, and the smears layer that transmit the force on the skin. And the smears, below this smears layer, all the vascular supply and the nerve supply of the nose. So below this below the smears layer, we have a complete avascular plane for the surgery. So your the plane of the dissection, that should be the sub smears area. So these all about the soft tissue envelope, the importance of the soft tissue envelope, regarding the surgical landmark, regarding the blood supplies, and regarding the other important things. Now, before to start the dissection, another important step for the rhinoplasty, that is the infiltrations. So there are so many beginners, they bias that how they infiltrate. So because for proper hemostasis and getting the good plane, the proper infiltration is mandatory. So for infiltration, we use 2% xylocaine with the adenylene and 1:1 lakh solutions. And we use, I use the 5 ml syringe and we usually use the 26 gauge needle, 1.5 inch needle. So that is the good for the infiltration. And the infiltration part in the nose, we can learn in the 5 steps. So in the first step, we infiltrate in the septum. So whenever you infiltrate in the septum, then according to your pathology, first you assess the pathology, then you assess in the pathology, and then you infiltrate according to nasal speculum. Then you infiltrate. So whenever you infiltrate in the septum, suppose your patient have a caudal pathology or the caudal deformity, then you particularly infiltrate for the hemitransfix as an incision, because we use the 2 incisions for the septal pathology. One is the hemitransfix as an incision. That hemitransfix as an incision, that is usually we put on the most caudal part of the, along the caudal margin of the caudal septum. But another, that is the Killian's incision, that is the junction of the vestibular skin and the mucosa. So suppose your patient have the posterior pathology, posterior part of the septum, you have the pathology, then the Killian's incision is good. But if your patient have a caudal pathology, caudal septum deviation, in such case, you infiltrate on the most prominent part of the caudal septum. And your incision from the anterior septal angle to the posterior septal angle, then your incision is different. That is the hemitransfix as an incision. But if your if you put the Killian's incision and your patient have a caudal septum deformity, then it's very difficult to reconstruct. Some renowned surgeon, they infiltrate only in the margins of the for the septum. So whenever you infiltrate, like, then there is usually a belching in the vestibular mucosa. I think you never seen this one. But if either there is a ballooning rather than the belching, that is the good. So this is the first step of the infiltration. For the second step of infiltration, for the transcolumella incision. So whenever you infiltrate for the transcolumella incision, then you infiltrate in the tip. So first you infiltrate from the tip defining point to like this, from the tip defining point to the anterior nasal spine, and then after between the dome area. Then for the dome area. So after infiltrate in the dome area, by a index finger and the thumb, you disperse this and wet for some times. And you also infiltrate little bit in the 0.2 or 3 ml on the marginal incision is in this columellar area on the both sides. On the both sides. So this is the second step of the infiltration for the transcolumella incisions. And the third, for the marginal incision. Then it's a very important thing. Then how you identify where the marginal incision, once we open the nose, then later we see. But isko cap lagana, iska cap lagana. So you can feel this margin of the lateral crust by a cap of syringe. This is the methods, or you can use a handle of scalpel, so you can also feel this is your margin of the lateral crust. So you infiltrate along the margin of the lateral crust. First you feel, then where you infiltrate, then you feel along this margin of the lateral crust by a double prong retractor on the same. So this is the second step of the infiltrations. And you never infiltrate, never go for the rim infiltrations or not posterior, and never infiltrate in the over amount, because then you distort the anatomy. Then the third step for the infiltrations, that is the on the dorsum. It's a very important thing. Dr. Pono also said that whenever you infiltrate on the dorsum, you then never infiltrate on the center part of the dorsum. If you infiltrate on the central part of the dorsum, then you hide some contour irregularities on the dorsum. So it's the better, it's the good things you, whenever you infiltrate between the upper lateral and the septum, then you infiltrate on the, this is the cadaver, so difficult. So either 1 centimeter lateral to, I marker dena. So 1 centimeter, I think, lateral to the paramedian. So this is the site where you infiltrate on the both of sides. So that you can preserve the contour irregularity and never in a much amount. So this is the third step for fourth step of the infiltration. And the last fifth step for the along the lateral nasal wall. So when we infiltrate on the lateral nasal wall, then at the anterior end of the inferior turbinate along the lateral nasal wall, you infiltrate for the osteotomy. There are so many surgeons that they infiltrate at the time of the osteotomy. So it's your, according to convenience, you can all also infiltrate at the time of the osteotomy also. So this is all about the local infiltration for the open rhinoplasty. Now, I think the 10 ml is adequate. 10 ml is adequate. Yeah. For the tip, 0.4, 0.5 ml, not much. Yeah. Because if you use the more, then you distort the anatomy. And after the infiltration, this is a good technique. You, by your index finger, thumb, you disperse it. So that is the good. So we open the nose for the opening of the nose. One another also important thing before to the start of the dissection, there is some important term that you have to know, like what is the exposure, what is the incision, what is the technique, and what is the approach. So one term, that is the approach. We use the open approach. Approach is basically a specific type of the anatomical dissections to get access in the osteocartilaginous framework. But the incision, that is a particularly surgically created cut to gain access in the osteocartilaginous framework. And the third term, that is the technique. Technique means a particularly maneuver. You change something like the cephalic trimming, lateral curve over technique. So these are the different term. And one other important term, one is the primary nose, one is the secondary nose, and one is the revision surgery. So primary nose, that nose have the never the history of the surgery. And the secondary nose, the nose that have the earliest history by the other surgeon, and the revision, that in nose the revised by Owen previous history. So these are the useful terms that you have to know to rhinoplasty. So the first part of the open rhinoplasty, like that, is the exposure. Like in the every surgery, the exposure part is the important part. So for the exposure, we use two type of the incision. One is the transcolumellar incision and other is the marginal incision. Or you can say that we use in the open approach marginal incision, or these both marginal incision we connect by the transcolumellar incision. Now, it's a very important thing, and sometimes there are so many beginner friends ask then, which type of the incision I use first, sir? Either is the marginal incision or the transcolumellar incision. So it's my friend, it's an important thing. You never resist on the one thing. Either you can use the transcolumellar first or the marginal incision first. It doesn't matter. How you are the more comfort, that is also important. Renowned Dr. Hossam Foda, they always use the first the marginal incision and then the transcolumellar incision. I early use first the marginal and then the transcolumellar. Now I always first do the transcolumellar and then marginal incision. So the next important thing, that is the I use the inverted V incision. So give them marker. First the mark the things. So this again an important thing. There is a different type of the incision, like the inverted V incision, stair step incision, W incision. So you never confuse about the incisions. All the incision is the broken line incision, and the motto and the goal of the broken line incision, that just we increase the length of, and the minimize the scar. When we use the broken line incision, then we have the minimum chance of the force of the contraction and the minimum chance of the scar. So we use in this the inverted V incision. So the important thing, the type of the incision is not important. The site of your site of the incision, that should be perfect. So the site of the incision, that should be in the mid part of the columella. Now, how you identify the mid part of the columella? If you identify from this to this one, that is wrong. The mid part from to apex of the nostril, this is the, because the columella start is from this area. So this is the mid part. If you, this is not the mid part. So when you measure the mid part of the columella, then the apex of this inverted V, that is on the narrowest, in the narrowest part of the columella, mid part of the columella. So the site of the incision, that is more important. So marking habit is also good. So we mark. So we mark this one, 15 number blade, 11 number blade. Now, after the marking, another important thing for inverted V incision, I usually use the 11 number blade. So the important thing, how you use your 11 blade, that is the important. Whenever you make their inverted V incision, then if you hold the knife like this one, okay, then you have a beveled margin, and if your margin is beveled, then you create a trapdoor deformity. So you hold your knife, you hold your scalpel perpendicular this skin, and you make this incision like this and this. Ideally, the distance between this both of the inverted V limb is 3 millimeter. So,
Dr. Sunil.
And then after the incision of the horizontal limb 15, then you can use Dr. Sunil, the 15 number blade. So,
hello.
This is the
Dr. Sunil.
Now, sometimes, if your patient, you want to deproject the nose, in that case, your incision, that should be little bit higher up. Because whenever you deproject the nose, then automatically the incision site is the mid. And another important thing, there are so many beginners, they ask that whenever you classic bender's case, then if you use this incision, then it's very difficult because your columella flap, that is very short, and after the projection and after the augmentation, it's very difficult to close the incision site. So if you have a binder's case, 15 marker dena, if you have a binder's case, then it's a good technique of Dr. Pradeep Goyal sir, then your incision that should be in the low in the columella, like according to the length of your columella. So your incision is just like a V-shaped on this one. So that is the V-shaped incision. So this part of the skin that add in the columella flap, and you increase length of your columella. So this length you can get whenever you close after the augmentations of the, after the projection of the tip, and after the undermining of the both of this skin, then you can close it. So that is the V2Y closure. That is the V2Y closure. It's a very important step, because it's a very frustrating when you create a very good definition tip, but after that, the closing problem. So whenever you have a binder's case, or wherever you have a short columella, so you assess the columella, assess the amount of projection, and according to that use the incision 15 number blade. So now after we have this vertical incisions. So this incision that is around 1 to 2 millimeter behind the margins, 1 to 2 millimeter behind the skin margins. Both sides. मेरे को इधर से दिख नहीं रहा. Now you complete this incision on the both sides. Once your incision is complete, then you just take a sharp scissors and then from the ipsilateral side to the contralateral side, then from the ipsilateral side to the contralateral sides, and this is an important thing. This is a crucial step. You never force your scissor. If you force your scissor, then you create the false track. If you feel resistance in your scissor, then you change your direction of the scissor from the contralateral side, like this one. Because this is the step where the junior colleagues or the beginners have the maximum chance of the injury of the margin of the medial crust. And you stay superficial to this margin of the lateral crust, medial crust. 15 number. You finish your incision. So once you finish your incision, then it's an important technique, that is the 3-point traction technique. So in 3-point traction technique, you use the 3 prongs. One is the double wide double prong, and 2 the small prongs. So you use the counter tractions. Give me the sharp scissor. The first, before to start in the upward directions, you just take a sharp scissor and first you identify the margin of the medial crust. And it's a very good method of Dr. Pawn, that you identify the margin of the medial crust from the both sides. This margin of the medial crust on the right side and the margin of the medial crust on the left side. So this is basically you hold a scissor in the pen holding positions and then in upward direction. So now in the first, you never jump. First you complete your marginal incision. So this is the 3-point traction technique. That means one by your columella flap, by your non-dominant hand, and other by your assistant, and other by your assistant. So first you finish the margin of the little bit. And you along the margin of the lateral crust. Along the margin of the lateral crust. And it's a very important thing that there are so many my junior colleagues ask that what is the lateral limit of the incision. So for the lateral limit of the incision, I think you should expose at least 2/3 of the lateral crust area. So first you finish the incision. So
this is marginal incision.
Yeah.
This is
the marginal incision. This is the transcolumella incision and this is the marginal incision. So first you finish the marginal incision on the both sides. At least we should expose 2/3 of the lateral crust. Okay. And then you change your this prong. You just take it's a wide double prong hook. So by your non-dominant hand, then you hold this like one. Sometimes when you open the nose in the transcolumella, just a little bit uzzer, that is the branches of the superior labial artery columellar vessels. So you cauterize by a bipolar. Now it's an important thing. This is the 3-point traction technique. Now we expose the lateral crust first and then we dissect in the medial part. So the other important thing is now the plane of the dissections. इसको उठाना and give मेरे को काकीर वाला instrument देना. So the plane of the dissections is important, that in which my plane of the dissection, that is the supraperichondial and the subsmesh dissections. There are so many books, they mention the subperichondial dissection, the subperichondial plane, that is good. But friend, the important thing in the Indian subcontinent, in the Asian subcontinent, we have a very thick skin. So recently by a paper read by Dr. Lokesh on the Indian noses. So in the Indian noses, the skin is very thick. So if you go for the subperichondrial dissections, then ultimately you weak or lateral crust. And then consequently, the post-op, sometimes the patient develop ala retraction or ala collapse. So in rhinoplasty, there is no single rule. There is no single technique that you follow, that you always the subperichondrial. Sometimes maybe if your patient is thin skin, then definitely you can go subperichondrial. But I think the supraperichondrial, the dissection. So this is a very good instrument by Kakir. So we just by swap actions, we expose the lateral crust first. So on the both side, and you ask your assistant, then counter traction is also the important thing. Have you any question? Yeah, it's a kind of free as this instruments by the Baris Kakir. That is a very good instrument. The margin is good. So it's a very good instrument for exposure of the lateral crust. So first you expose the, and it's my advice to my beginners, that whenever you go, you start your career in rhinoplasty, sometimes the complication is happened, like the injury of the medial crust, injury of the lateral crust. So never lose your confidence, because someone, whenever do the surgery, then complication is usual. Suppose if the part of the lateral crust or the medial crust is injured, then never panic. In the last of the surgery, you can suture by a 6-0 or 5-0 PDA suture. There is no problem, because the learning is never ending. Give me the, and you can use this canvas scissor. This is the canvas scissor. This is very good for the dissection in the mid part. So this is the ligament that connect this both of the lateral crust and the dome area with this soft tissue envelope. So this is the ligament of the pitangui that connect, is a minor tip support mechanisms. So we cut it, and now we expose the entire LR cartilage. So first, when you finish your LR cartilage, then your focus for the mid wall dissections. So for the mid wall dissections, you can use by the scissor or this Kakir instrument. So you identify the anterior septal angle area, and you change this instrument. You just take the off-reach retractor, off-reach. Because it's also important thing where you use which instrument, otherwise you unnecessary struggle for the dissection. So when now you use the this one, and now you dissect after the mid vault, now you dissect the bony vault. You can use scissor also. It's your convenience according to use. And when you expose the dorsum, then it's an important thing. Then you first assess. Suppose you expose the dorsum and you the dissection on the dorsum, And if you want to augmentation of your dorsum, and then in that case, your pocket, that should be not too much, and you expose according to your level of the augmentations. Because if your pocket is, if you expose a lot of, then you need a lot of material for the augmentations, and your dorsal graft that is not snugly fit. Periosteum elevator, dusra, Joseph wala. Yeah, over the bone, the subperiosteal, or the bone, the subperiosteal. And suppose if you need, like, if your case is a crooked nose, if your case is a gross saddle, in that case, your exposure should be properly on either side of the, on 1 centimeter either side of the dorsums. So for the proper fixing of your graft, for the proper osteotomy, and the, for the proper, if you have a crooked nose, then for the proper assess your septum. So this is the Joseph periosteal elevator. It's a very good instrument for the subperiosteal dissections. So like this one, by swapping actions, like the swapping actions, you on the both sides of you expose, and your feel on, whenever you work on the feel, then you feel on the bone. You can have sound also on the. So now, इसको इससे पकड़ना. So once your exposure part is complete, first the tip exposure, and then mid vault, and then upper vault, then now we expose the septum. You hold this one. Give me the double cartilage holding forceps. So look at the. First we just check some anatomy also, we revise. You always make a habit, like hold it, like this is the nose. So first you identify the abnormality, deformity in your mind, that this deformity in which deformity underlying the skin. Once you open the nose, whenever you open the nose, that you confirm that deformity, that in which part, either you presume the anatomical deformity. So that is a good habit for a assessment. Double holding forceps. So now we open both this. So this is the method. Now, for the septum exposure, first we give the counter traction by a cartilage holding forceps. You use this cartilage holding forceps because this have the serration, so it's a very good forceps. And then by the counter tractions, we cut this normal part. And then we identify the anterior septal angle area. It's my advice to my the junior friends, really it's a very delicate step, and in the whole of the rhinoplasty, in the, this is most important delicate step, because sometimes whenever you expose this anterior septal angle area, like in the crooked nose or underdeveloped caudal septum case, then you have the little bit difficulty to identify this one. But you keep patience and you do the dissections slowly. Then first you identify the anterior septal angle. This is my anterior septal angle. I feel my septum. This is my septum. So little bit you expose, and you can use this scissor. Just you hold this scissor like a pen holding positions. You can also use this periosteum elevator also, how you are more comfortable. I usually use this scissor just as a periosteum elevator, and you look that. So in a crooked nose case, then really you have the difficulty, because then the caudal septum is distorted. Look that. Now, this is my submucoperichondrial pocket. This is my submucoperichondrial pocket. So then you change your instrument. It's a very good periostem elevator by the Storch. So once you make on the one side, and it's an important thing, then whenever you raise the mucoperichondrial flag, then always you start the mucoperichondrial dissection in the upper part of the septum. Because in this upper part of the septum, this mucoperichondrium, that is the less adherent rather than the other area. So the sequence of the dissections, first in the upper part and then the lower part and then posterior superior part and then posterior inferior in the warmer area and in the last in the anterior inferior in the maxillary tuberosity area, subperiosteal plane. So once your one side dissection is finished, then you hold this caudal part of the septum. You can use either the scissor or this instrument slowly, slowly. So if suppose one side of the your mucoperichondrial flap is tear, then it's never panic. And slowly, slowly you change your the direction, you change your site and go on other side. Nasal speculum. So once you raise on the both sides, then you just take this periosteum elevator. Now I expose my entire septum from the both sides. Now give me a scissor. For the better learning and the better exposure, I cut this skin. Look at the thickness of this soft tissue envelope. एक वो लगा दे इस पे ये लगा दे ओके सो नाउ वी कंप्लीटली एक्सपोज सो नाउ वी सेपरेट और अपर लेटरल एंड द सेप्टम एंड इट्स आल्सो इंपॉर्टेंट थिंग दैट इन नॉट इन एवरी केस दैट यू नीड the separation of the upper lateral and the septum. But the important thing, whenever you separate the upper lateral and the septum, then first you complete your mucoperichondrial dissections. You complete your mucoperichondrial tunnel till the top of the septum. 15 number plate. So I cut this one. I separate this upper lateral and the septum. So this side upper lateral, this is my upper lateral cartilage and this is my septum. And on another side, but whenever you separate the upper lateral cartilage, the remember thing, that should be the mucoperichondrial, not supraperichondrial. So now you decide the or exposure part, that is the complete. It's an important thing, like sometimes whenever a patient have a crooked nose, then in crooked nose cases, if you not separate this upper lateral cartilage and the septum, then it's very difficult to straightening the septum because this upper lateral cartilage have some extrinsic force on this septum. Give me the two swatches. No, not in every cases, not in all cases. First you assess like if your mid vault is good and if your dorsum is straight and you no need any modification of the mid vault, then you no need to open the mid vault. But if your case is like you want to, you have a hump nose or you have a crooked nose, because in the crooked nose, what happened? There is two type of the force that on the septum. One is the extrinsic force and one is the intrinsic force. So the bony vault and the upper lateral, this bony vault and this upper lateral cartilage have a extrinsic force on the septum. So until unless you not separate the upper lateral attachment of the upper lateral and the septum, then it's very difficult to allow in the midline this dorsal part of the septum. So you always, in that case, you separate, or you want to the other septal work, septal pathology, in that case you need the separations. In case of the dorsal hump, I think you separate this upper lateral and the septum, then it's after the separation you can better judge the amount and the exact degree of the hump, so you can better remove the hump. So it's a good habit, in that case you separate the upper lateral and the septum.
Hi, Dr. Sunil.
Number, please.
Hello.
Now, after the
Hello.
Separation of the upper lateral and the septum.
Hello.
Now, we do the septal work. For the septal work, after the separation of the upper lateral and the septum,
Hello. Hello. Hi, Sunil. Dr. Sunil.
According to that, like if
can you hear me?
You change your direction of the nasal speculum. Give me. Now you use either the Belanger knife, or this is a very good instrument for separation of the septal cartilage from the perpendicular plate. Voice agi? Theek hai? Carry on. Achha, theek. Yeah. And you just try to harvest as maximum the septal cartilage piece. Give me forceps. So this is my septal cartilage piece. This is the part of the bony part, and this is the septal cartilage. So you should harvest as much as maximum. Now, when you remove the deviated part of the septum, then you release some intrinsic force on the septum, and you allow the septum in the midline. So, once you harvest the septum, then you reconstruct the septum before to start the other work. For reconstruct of the septum, if a patient have a hump, then you exact judge the amount of the hump in the caudal part. We excise that, and the caudal part we also assess. Sometimes the patient have a excess caudal septum or the deviation of the caudal, and the caudal septum is deviated from the midline. Sometimes the caudal septum is on the one side. In that case, the first you separate the complete caudal septum. Sir? आई थिंक उसको बोलना ऑडियो विजुअल वाले को कि वो कोई भी ज्वाइन नहीं कर पा रही फैकल्टी, कोई टेक्निकल प्रॉब्लम तो नहीं है. सो दिस इज माय कॉडल पार्ट ऑफ द सेप्टम. दिस कॉडल पार्ट ऑफ द सेप्टम, यू नो दिस कॉडल पार्ट ऑफ द सेप्टम इज अराउंड द 2 to 4 millimeter प्रोट्रूड बिटवीन द मीडियल क्रस्ट. So this relation is important. If more than protrusion between the medial crust, then we have the overhanging columella, and then less than this, then the patient have a retracted columella. And due to this relationship of this attachment between the caudal septum and the medial crust, we have some columella show. Because the nose have three important relations. One relation, that is the relation between the ala margin and the columella, and other relation, the relation between the bony base width and the ala base width, and third important relation between the anterior septal angle area and the dome region. So these three important relation you should know. Hello. Hi, Dr. Amar Singh. Hello.
Hey, Dr. Sunil.
Yeah, sir. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. We cannot interact with you because I think you have kept us on unmuted.
Asked my audiovisual person.
Yeah. I think it's a very difficult.
Dekhna ek baar sir ka.
Yeah. Now I can hear you. Yes.
You audible,
am I audible
me?
To you?
Sir, you hearing me?
Yes, I can hear you now. So far, we were not able to interact with you. I think we were muted.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Good.
Since long time, we are waiting for you.
Excellent.
Yeah, sir. Thank you. So we just expose the nose and we just discuss about the caudal part of the septum. So after the harvesting the septal cartilage, the another important thing, how you fix your caudal septum. So for the caudal septum fixation in the midline, then you first expose the caudal part of the septum, give me the double pronged retractor, big double pronged retractor. So ask your assistant, like you hold like this one, and by another 2 double pronged retractor, you just, because the exposure part is the important in your surgery. So you expose first. This caudal septum is already in the midline, but sometimes if the caudal part of the septum, that is if the node midline, then first you completely separate the bony attachment and the cartilage attachment like this one. You completely free the attachment of the caudal part of the septum. And sometimes if you have a excess part of this caudal or the twisted or the dorsum part, then you excise this excess part. Because if you not excise, then the force of this deviated part that not allow to come midline in the septum. So once you excise it and trimming it and come in the midline, then you fix it. So there is a different way to fixation. Give me the 40 PDS. There are so many way to fix the caudal part of the septum in the central. So some people the use of a burr hole in the anterior nasal spine, but In Indian patients, because in Caucasian patient, the anterior nasal spine is prominent. So in that case, to make a hole in the anterior nasal spine is easy. But in Indian patients, the anterior nasal spine is not so prominent. You can do, but it's not easy to make a hole in the anterior nasal spine and the fix of the and caudal part of the septum. Yeah.
Sunil, just to highlight to everyone, septum surgery is the foundation of rhinoplasty surgery.
Yes,
both
sir.
Aesthetic
yes,
as well as functional aspect. So
yes, sir. So
this is very important part of the surgical.
Really, sir. Really.
Exercise.
Dr. Kapil. Hello, Dr. Kapil Agarwal. I think he's not still down.
Yes, I'm here.
Oh, good afternoon, boss.
Good afternoon. You're doing very good job.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
So, this is a very easy method. Yeah. So, this is a very easy method. Then, how you fix your caudal part of the septum? Then, you just take a 40 PDS sutures and you make a suture in the perichondrium. Hold on. So you make a suture in the perichondrium. So this is my suture in the perichondrium and then in the caudal part. A gloss pen. Gloss pen le beta ek bar. थ्रेड छोटा रखना सो बाय दिस मेथड्स यू कैन इजीली फिक्स दिस कोडल पार्ट ऑफ द सेप्टम विद द पेरिकोंड्रियम इन द मिड लाइन सो नाउ योर कोडल पार्ट ऑफ द सेप्टम इज फिक्स इन द मिड लाइन यू कैन ऑल्सो यूज द burr hole in the antenasal spines. The important thing, how you are the more convenient, that's the main thing. Cut it. Dr. Amar Singh, sir, how you fix the caudal part of the septum? By which method, sir?
Well, I use most of the time the drill. I make a small drill hole.
Okay, sir.
And depends upon the deformity and each case is different, of course. But I try to make a very firm fixation. But sometimes I don't find a very small rudimentary spine. Then in those cases, I do exactly what you are doing.
Yes, sir. Periosteum dena. So once your septal work is complete, leave it. Once your septal work is complete, then you can use as sutures in the mucoperichondrium on the both sides. That is the quilting sutures. So quilting suture is the horizontal matrix suture. 40 or 30 कुछ PDS जो भी हो दे दें मेरे को quilting suture के लिए. So pit वो नहीं vicryl दे देना बड़ा.
I think Sunil, what you are trying to demonstrate is the first people where the you don't need to do such extensive work on the osteocartilage structure. Patient, those who have a minimal hump, cartilage is bony deformity, bony hump.
Yes,
and,
sir.
Some amount of, you find a septal deformity. In those kind of cases, what you are doing is the perfect job, yes. Otherwise,
yes,
this step, you can keep it at the end of the surgery where you need, like in crooked cases, crooked nose cases, or there is large hump where you need to do the complete mobilization by osteotomies. And then
cut it.
To complete rest of the work and this you can delay it at the end of the surgery.
Yes, sir. Exactly, sir. So,
this sequence may change according to the deformity and type of patients and what you have preoperatively planned for the patient.
Yeah, sir. So, after the exposure, we just finished some septal work and now we first discuss about the modification of the bony vault. Give the seizure. So, for the modification of the bony vault, we have only one procedure, that is the osteotomy. So, really, the osteotomy is a very challenging subject because this is the most traumatic and the least controllable step. So the first we understand that what is the osteotomy. So basically the osteotomy is the control fracture of the nasal bone and the ascending process of the maxilla. So for better understanding of this osteotomy, we first know about the exact morphology of the bony vault, what is about detail about the bony vault and the either the need of the osteotomy, when we do the osteotomy, and other important thing, you know, detailed knowledge about the seizure, about the osteotomes. So first we see the exact morphology of the bony vault. So for the morphology of the bony vault, the length of this bony vault, this is my this is my bony vault. So the length of this bony vault, that is around the 2.5 centimeter, and the shape of this nasal bone, the shape of the nasal bone is just the hourglass shape, because the nasal bone have the variation in the size. The nasal bone have the maximum width in the nasofrontal area and around the 14 millimeter, but gradually this width is reduced and then again widened. So due to the variation in the size of this nasal bone, we have the this dorsal aesthetic line. We have the hourglass shape, and due to this hourglass shape, we have the dorsal aesthetic line when we met from the this medial part of the eyebrow with the tip defining point. So this dorsal aesthetic line indicate the contour irregularities of the dorsum.
Dr. Sunil, at this stage, can you take your marker pen and try to define the keystone area? Just mark so that for your audience become very clear. And
yes, sir.
Because you already have dissected out. So yeah. Just try to mark out the keystone area and anatomy of the upper lateral from the...
Yeah, we show that keystone area. So...
Take a marker pen.
Yeah, sir. Definitely we show. But first we do the osteotomy, and then once the nose, this vault is open, then we show the keystone area. So this upper lateral cartilage, and this is my bony. So this is the keystone area. This is my keystone area. This is my keystone area. This is the peripheral keystone area. This is the central keystone area, because this is the attachment. Because on the central keystone area, the overlapping of this distal part of this nasal bone and the proximal part of the upper lateral cartilage is maximum.
Yes.
So this part of the upper lateral cartilage have the maximum support from this area. So this is the importance of the keystone area. We maintain this keystone area. We maintain the integrity of the keystone area. Now,
can I add little more into this now, what you are doing it?
Yes, sir.
What you said? Now, what you mentioned, there are two things. What previously we knew was there were only one single keystone area in the midline, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Now with the introduction of this preservation rhinoplasty, we know now there is one lateral keystone area also. One is central keystone area, junction of the in the midline. Another is the lateral keystone area, that is the junction. Yeah, can you just retract this one? Yeah, that's good.
So there is different type of the osteotomy. There is different type of the indication of the osteotomy. So if we first, before to the osteotomy, we should knowledge about the instrument, about the knowledge of the osteotome. So different type of the osteotome, that's osteotome is two types. One is the straight osteotome and other is the curved osteotome. And one is guarded osteotome and another is the unguarded osteotome. So whenever we use the guarded osteotome, then it's easy to feel, it is to do the osteotomy, because we feel this guarding end always. But on the other hand, we have some disadvantage that we have the more chance of the injury of the periosteal attachment. So you have the more chance of the edema later. But the important thing you can use either the guarded or the straight. How you are the more confident, how you are the more comfort, that is the better thing. I think this is the good thing. So for the types of the osteotomy, there is a different type of the osteotomy. So if we deal with this, the medial part of the osteotomy, then is the medial osteotomy. And if we deal with the lateral most part of the nasal bone, that is the lateral osteotomy. And the part between these two, that is the intermediate osteotomy. And the upper part and the root of those, this is the transverse osteotomy. So these are the different type of the osteotomy. First, we discuss the lateral osteotomy. For the lateral osteotomy, the two important things. First is the approach of the lateral osteotomy, or either the pattern of the osteotomy. Because for the lateral osteotomy, we have the two approach. Either we can do this osteotomy from the outside of the nose, that is the external osteotomy, external percutaneous osteotomy, and you can do from the inside, that is the internal continuous lateral osteotomy. So it's very confusing to most of my beginners friends that what is the exact pathway of the osteotomy, what is the pattern of the osteotomy. So the pattern of the osteotomy, because once when the osteotomy is discovered by the Joseph, then the initially the pathway of the osteotomy from then the from the lowermost part of the piriform aperture to the upper end of the nasal bone in the same pathway, that is the low to low osteotomy. So there is two word, one is the high and another is the low. That means the high, that means the towards the dorsum, and low towards the maxilla. So at that time, when the osteotomy discovered, then the pathway of the osteotomy from the lowermost part of the piriform aperture to the upper part of the nasal bone is the same. But consequently, the Webster realized then in this pathway, the patient developed the problem, because when you do the osteotomy low to low, then we injured the Webster triangle area. We already discussed that Webster triangle area is the laterally attachment of the upper lateral cartilage, and on the same side, the anterior end of the inferior turbinate is also attached. So if we damage that Webster triangle area, then the both are medialized, and consequently the patient develop the airway breathing problems. So he realized, rather than go for a low, we go little bit high towards the dorsum, then we can preserve this Webster triangle area, and the consequently later we can preserve the airway patency. And the same thing on the upper end, if we rather than low, after once we reach at the level of the intercanthal line, if we change the pathway, then we can preserve the bone deformity, that is the rocker deformity. So the rocker deformity, then if we enter directly in the thick part of the nasal bone in the low to low pathway, then the part of the nasal bone is the feel. So the high low high pattern, that is the standard pattern of the osteotomy we usually use in the osteotomy. But sometimes the indication of the low to low still, because sometimes the patient have a wide bony base width, because there is two width of this bony vault. One is the bony base width, and another is the dorsal width. So bony base width, that is the exactly width between these two sides of the ascending process of the maxilla, that is the bony base width. But dorsum width, the width between this nasal bone. So sometimes, suppose your patient have a excessive wide bony base width, and in that case you do the high low high, in that case you develop a step, that is the step deformity, because this part of the nasal bone is broad and your plane of your pattern of the osteotomy is higher, then you create a step deformity. So this is the pattern of the lateral osteotomy. First we do the external osteotomy, 2 mm osteotome I usually use. And now we see the pathway of the external osteotomy in the nasofacial groove, in the nasofacial groove. So exact where I, so exact my, this is my osteotome. This is my osteotome, and the exact pathway of this osteotome, that is fissure, you know, that is not in the nasal bone. That exact the pathway of the osteotome, big fissure, in the ascending process of the maxilla. Thoda sa isko. Okay. So now you use the two tap technique, trip tap, and once you hold for the external, but once you hold this your osteotome, that is on the 70 degree angle, so you can prevent the injury of the septum. So tap tap. So look that where I am working here. So look that. So I am working here. This is my working plane. Tap tap. So this is basically the osteotomy in a postage stamp manner. We have a multiple perforations, and there is around the 2 millimeter space between these two perforations. And once we have them complete this osteotomy, then by green stick fractures, by the pressing, we can move this nasal bone. And another, that is the internal osteotomy, lateral osteotomy. When we do the internal lateral osteotomy, then give me the first, the infiltration, and then after infiltration, first, that is the incision site. So the incision site, that is the at the anterior to the head of the inferior turbinate. So this is my inferior turbinate, and at the upper end of this inferior turbinate, I make an incision. So the incision, the important thing, the incision not like this. The incision that should be the horizontal. The incision that should be the horizontal on the upper part of the inferior turbinate. So this is around the 3 millimeter incision. This is around the, and you can feel the bony part, the lower end of the piriform aperture by this knife. And once your incision is complete, then you use this guarded osteotome. So this is the two osteotome. Give me another one. One is the right side and dusre wala. One is the right side and another is the left side. So this is my right side guarded osteotome, and this is my left side. So it's an important thing for my junior colleagues, for my beginners. This part of the guarding end is on outside. When you engage, then you engage like this one. Suppose this is your left side. So once when you engage your osteotome, then this guarding end is on outside, and throughout the pathway of the osteotome, you can feel by a non-dominant hand finger. So where you are working, you can assess. So this is a very good thing in this guarding osteotome. So now once you engage this one, give me. So when you engage this in this incision, then your osteotome, that should be vertical like this, not like horizontal. So you hold your osteotome in the vertical directions. First for engage properly and tap tap, and now stop, and now gradually tap, gradually come down tap. Now once you at the level of the parallel to this, then you change your direction of your hand, and then another hand on your guarding end. Love, tap. So we expose this one. We expose this one to show the better way. Give me the periosteum. So we also expose from this. So we can see that where we are working. Because really the osteotomy in the beginnings is a very biased, confusing thing, that what is the low to low, what is the high low.
So it is always necessary to.
Yeah.
It is always necessary to.
Yeah. This is the good, because if you make like this one, then you have don't much space for the engagement of your osteotom. If you make the horizontal incision, because your osteotome is transverse, not like this one, so that is the better to make the incisions. Yeah. So give me this one. Left side osteotome. So now you can see, I think, tap. Now you observe, tap. Dhire. So look that this is my guarding end. This is my guarding end. And if I feel, then I am on the nasofacial groove. I feel this guarding end by my finger. But actually, my plane of the dissection, my plane of my osteotom is this one. So, so I change the directions. Tap, tap. So once I reach at the level of the intercanthus, then I go a little bit higher, because this is the high-low, high osteotomy. Tap. Okay. So now you just, once you finish, then you rotate your osteotome. On the left side, you rotate in the anti-clockwise fashion, but on the right side, in the clockwise fashion. So I just rotate like this. So when I rotate like this, then your this nasal bone, that is the completely free. So now this nasal bone is completely free. So this is my pathway of this osteotomy, lateral osteotomy. So either you do the external or either the internal osteotomy is a matter of debate, that which one is the good, because there are so many times or junior colleagues see in a conference or courses that someone say that the external is good and the internal is good. But I think you can do either the internal or external. The important thing, how is your more confidential, that is good. According to the literature, when you do the external osteotomy, then external osteotomy is the more precise and the preserve the periosteal attachment of the osteomyelitis segment. So the better healing. But on the other hand, the disadvantage of the scar. But usually in my practice, I think I never see the scar in a 2 mm osteotome. On the other hand, we use the internal continuous lateral osteotomy, then you have the consistent narrowing of this bony vault, because you feel the guarding end throughout the course of the osteotomy. But the disadvantage that sometimes we have this piriform stenosis. And another important thing, when you damage the periosteal attachment of the osteomyelitis segment, then the healing is delayed and you have the more edema later. So this is the merit and the demerits, advantage and the disadvantage of the external and the internal osteotomy. But the most important thing, then how your boss is doing, how your professor is doing, how is your schooling, that is the good. Sir, what is your opinion for that? Which one is good? Hello?
Yes, you're asking me, Sunil?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. See, osteotomy...
What is your message for my for our junior colleagues?
Yeah, my message would be to... First thing is, before you take the patient to theater, in the clinic itself, your decision should be made whether this patient needs osteotomy or not, number one.
Yes, sir.
Osteotomy needs, then what type of osteotomy I am going to correct the nasal deformity, osteocartilaginous vault. Number three question would be, then if I have to do external or internal, that will depend on your experience and how much you are comfortable. If you learn about internal osteotomy, then do it with the internal only. I started doing with the internal first. And then if you are comfortable with external, do it comfortable with the external. Don't jump to switch something which you are not familiar or you are not comfortable. So do whichever method you are doing it. So this is, I think, a most important thing. And don't change the thing, osteotomy, on the table that I will do this one, that one. So whatever you have decided preoperatively, do that.
Yes, sir. So it's really a very important message by Dr. Amar Singh that first you assess either you need or not the osteotomy. So how you assess that your patient is need or not the osteotomy? So there is a relation, some aesthetic, when you do the aesthetic analysis of your nose, then your bony base width is the around the 80%, around the 2/3 of this ala base width. So this ala base width is equal to this intracanthal distance. So your bony base width is more than this, then you need the osteotomy. And another most important thing, according to you, your patient needs the osteotomy, but I think it's my personal opinion. Then if your what your patient want, if your patient desire about the only tip work and he doesn't bother for the whitening of the nose, you never do, I think, the osteotomy. The more important thing, how your patient is comfort, how your patient is happy, because if your patient is not happy, according to your nose is very good, then I think it's not good in the rhinoplasty. So first you judge, then you need the osteotomy. What is the indication of the osteotomy? You know, like the different indication of the osteotomy, that for the straightening of the deviated septum or for the narrowing of the excessive wide bony dorsum, or the sometimes in some situation when your bony dorsum is excessive narrow. So for the widening of, you need the osteotomy, and sometimes to maintain the dorsal aesthetic line. So these are the different indication of the osteotomy. And you also remember the contraindication of the osteotomy, because sometimes in some patient when the nasal bone is so short, nasal bone is so congenital short, in that case, the osteotomy is, I think, contraindicated. Because what happened in such case, if you do the osteotomy, then when nasal bone is short, then obviously the upper lateral cartilage is long. So in that case, when you do the osteotomy, then the nasal bone that is fragmented, that is the multiple, due to he lost the support for the upper lateral cartilage. So the upper lateral cartilage is inferomedially fall down, and the consequently the patient develop the inverted V deformity. So that is a one contraindication of the osteotomy. Or sometimes the when a patient with thin fragile bone, because the thickness of the nasal bone is the in the different, the thickness of the nasal bone that is on the nasofrontal suture area is around the 7 millimeter, and then gradually this nasal bone is taper. So this upper part of the nasal bone is act as a cantilever for this entire nose, but in the lower part of the lowermost part of the lateral part, the nasal bone thickness is vary in the male or female. In the female patient is around the 2.30 millimeter, and the male patient is down the 2.4. So when you analyze the nose, then each and every step is important. So after the lateral osteotomy, we discuss about the medial osteotomy. Give me the this one also. So
second thing. Can sir. I add one more point, Sunil?
Sir.
Yeah, because the osteotomy is the most traumatic part of the rhinoplasty surgery. And whether you do by close with your internal or percutaneous, it is the judgment. It is surgeon judgment, basically. And one should try to do the osteotomy in a very graded way, meaning your slant cases where you need to do, are comfortable doing with the least amount of osteotomy. And then as you get more experience, then try to build up your...
Exactly, sir. It's a surgeon judgment. But if patient doesn't want the narrowing of the nose, I think you judge that this patient needs the osteotomy. In such case, what is your opinion, sir?
Yeah, in cases, can you repeat your question?
Sir,
can you repeat your query?
I think when we analyze the nose, when we examine the nose, then the patient need the osteotomy. Yes. According to your judgment, according to your analysis, but patient need only sometimes tip work. The patient asks that my nose is dorsum is good. I no need narrowing of the nose. In such case, what is your opinion?
No. The thing is that in that case, what happens is sometimes, yes, they are the, you have to analyze the major deformity with the patient, what patient wants. What happens is at the end of the day, when the patient comes later on to you, it is surgeons, your analysis that makes a very important decision making. And if you feel that on analysis, patient needs some kind of osteotomy, you must tell the patient, yeah, you need to do this kind of, you need to work on that part also. I need to do osteotomy. Then you should go for the, because what happens is later on the patient says, you have done good tip work. You have done little, you know, dorsal modification, but the patient feels, oh my, this lateral wall is still broad. And patient was not complaining. But later on, then that becomes a point of your discussion with the patient. Why I do not do that osteotomy? So minor deformities, we should try to point out to the patient. And according to your judgment, you should try to do correct that part as well. But you must inform the patient, this is what I'm going to do it.
Yes, sir. Yeah. It's very important message.
Yeah. No. Why? Because why I wanted to the osteotomy put in question was, reason is, it is most traumatic part of the surgery, and we have seen cases coming to us from somewhere different places with the CSF rhinorrhea, where the surgeon has gone into the intracranial fossa osteotomy.
Yeah.
And orbital injuries, eye is no further from your surgical field. So there can be a very serious complications. And since it is a blind procedure during rhinoplasty, whether open or closed, so one should be very, very thorough in your clinical anatomy and variation in anatomy as well as what you are doing.
Yeah, sir, but there is one another important thing. What is your sequence of the work? Like after the exposure, sometimes some surgeon first the prefer the tip work and some surgeon prefer the bony work. So which work you prefer? Either you first the osteotomy or the tip work first? What is your suggestion? What is your message, sir?
No, nowadays, you know, what has happened is the surgical concept has changed. Rhinoplasty is not what we were doing about 20 years ago or 10 years ago. Every few years, a couple of years, you find new concepts come. Yes, now principle of the surgery is first, you should try to dorsum surgery first. Okay. Try to define the dorsum. What is the best suited for the patient? Yeah. Once you define the dorsum, then you try to do the dorsum, what I mean to say, hump, etc., both bony cartilaginous, do osteotomy after doing septum. Tip comes last because you cannot redo the tip if you have done tip first. So tip work, you can project or under project, rotate, derotate, whatever you do it at the end of the surgery, depending upon the height of the dorsum. Because dorsal height is very, very important for at the end of the surgery and for the patient.
Yes, sir. So really, it's a very important message that first you finish your dorsum work and then your tip work, because the tip work is the delicate work and the osteotomy is little bit crude work. So first you make your dorsum work, so you judge then the relationship between the anterior septal angle area and the dome area, so you give a predictable good tip work. Now, after the lateral osteotomy, we do the medial osteotomy. So, for the median osteotomy, the first thing, the purpose of the median osteotomy, why we do the median osteotomy, and what is the goal of the median osteotomy? All osteotomy, just we reposition of this nasal bone, but while maintain the stability of the nasal bone, we change the we reposition the position of the nasal bone, but the stability of the nasal bone we should maintain. So first we engage this osteotome between the just lateral position in junction of bony septum and the bony septum and the cartilage, and ideally sometimes some colleagues, junior colleagues, bias that which is pyramidian osteotomy, which is the medial osteotomy, which is median osteotomy. But actually, that is the pyramidian osteotomy, because we engage this osteotome in parasagittal manner.
And Sunil, if you have 4 millimeter osteotome, better use 4 millimeter osteotome instead of this large, if you have in your set.
Yeah, I have this one,
what
sir.
You are showing, this step.
So we give in. So look that you, by your non-dominant hand, you can throw out this osteotomy. You can feel this part of the osteotome and use this at the on the 15 to 20 degree at the off on the paramedian situation, and the upper limit look that the upper limit that the at the level of the intercanthal lines, tap. But sometimes in a crooked nose during the medial osteotomy, the keystone area is disrupted. So I think if you can change the pattern of the median osteotomy, like rather than go from the median osteotomy from the like this one, you do the median osteotomy like this from the transvestibular area. So you engage your osteotomy like that, little far away from the K area. So by this way, you can preserve the keystone area. So by through the transvestibular area. So by the median osteotomy, we just complete, we give the independent movement of the lateral, this nasal bone. So this about the medial osteotomy, and then we, the intermediate osteotomy. So the intermediate osteotomy, we usually need the medial and lateral osteotomy, but there is certain important indication for the intermediate osteotomy, because intermediate osteotomy, whenever we do, then first assess, sometimes when the nasal bone, when the bony vault, that is the asymmetrical, that when one side of the nasal bone is longer than other, one side of the nasal bone is concave and other is the convex. In that case, for mobilization of this bony vault, you need the intermediate osteotomy. So in intermediate osteotomy, the important thing, whenever you plan the intermediate osteotomy, then you always do the intermediate osteotomy before to the lateral or medial osteotomy. In lateral or medial osteotomy, it doesn't matter, you can do first the lateral or medial. But whenever you plan the intermediate osteotomy, then first you do the intermediate osteotomy. The reason, because if first you do the lateral osteotomy and then later you do the intermediate osteotomy, then once the nasal bone is destabilized, then you cannot complete, you cannot finish your intermediate osteotomy. So it's an important message. Then you need the double osteotomy, then you first do the higher osteotomy first. And another important thing, whenever you have a crooked nose, then in crooked nose, suppose your bony dorsum is one side is deviated and the concave and another is the convex side. So in that case, when you start your career in rhinoplasty, then sometimes if you do the osteotomy first on the convex side, then it's a very frustrating job. You cannot straight the deviated bony dorsum, because once you first do the convex side, then it's very difficult to move the convex bone. So in that case, first you do the concave side of the nasal bone, and then once you finish the concave side, then this nasal bone allow this convex side to the medialize. Dr. Kapil, what is your opinion for that? Hello?
Sir, Kapil, yeah, Sunil, you are right.
Yeah. So, this is the good sequence, boss?
Yes, yes.
So, if a crooked nose, when you use a combo of the osteotomy, then when you use the double level osteotomy, then first you use intermediate osteotomy first. So, we discuss about the lateral osteotomy, medial osteotomy, intermediate osteotomy, and another one important thing, sometimes you do a very good intermediate lateral and medial osteotomy, and after the rhinoplasty, once we remove the splint of the nose, still the root of the nose is deviated, and it's a frustrating job for you. So when you assess the nose, if your root of the nose is deviated, in that case, you need the transverse osteotomy. So in the transverse osteotomy, when you do the transverse osteotomy in the same by a multiple postage stamp manner, you free this deviated root, and the site of this transverse osteotomy below the nasion, tap tap. So we free this part of the root of the nasal bone by the transverse osteotomy. So whenever your root of the nose, especially in a crooked nose, then you need the different combo of the osteotomy. But if your root of the nose is deviated, then in that case you need the transverse osteotomy. Otherwise, you cannot straighten the septum. So this is all about the osteotomy. Amar Singh sir.
Yes. Yeah.
If you want to anything add more for beginners about the sequence of the osteotomy.
I think you have covered all aspects. I think in crooked nose especially, I think start first with your median or median oblique, and then perhaps in those cases you have to first do transverse, and then I usually combine with intermediate, then lateral most. And the next thing is about level of osteotomy, type of osteotomy we discussed, level of osteotomy.
Yes, sir.
In my opinion and my experience, I think this Western triangle is a myth. It has no significance. Yeah. It was described by 30, 40 years ago by Mr. Webster. But in current aspects of, I think, rhinoplasty surgery, so much of the preservation rhinoplasty going on, the Webster triangle has no significance. It has no significance. And in most of the cases, which especially in the crooked noses, you have to do the low to low osteotomy and combination of all osteotomy in order to mobilize the nasal pyramid. The most important part is the failure in crooked nose correction is surgeon has not mobilized the complete osteocartilaginous deformity. And that causes the recurrence of deviation.
Yes, sir. So it's a good important message. Then in the rhinoplasty, there is no single technique by which you can complete, and there is no rule, because individual case, individual nose have their great variation, and we use the different techniques. So after the bony vault modifications, we learn then how we modify the mid vault. So mid vault, this upper lateral cartilage is a very important, because it's the bridge, the upper and the mid lower vault. So for this, so for the modification of the mid vault, when we assess either the your patient have the like the crooked nose or the augmentation or the hump excision, so we use for the reconstruction of this the spreader graft usually. But it's the important thing, like whenever you use, like you use the spreader graft, you have to know that what is the indication of this spreader graft. It's not necessary then each and every case you open the upper lateral and the septum and you use the spreader graft. There is certain important indication of the spreader graft, like you have a deviated dorsum of the nose, or you have a inverted V deformity, or you have a open roof deformity. Sometimes when you excise the hump more than 1.5 centimeter, then you have a open roof deformity, and you get sometimes there is narrowing of the internasal wall secondary due to the upper lateral deformity. So in that case, you need the spreader grafts. Not in every case you need the spreader graft, because in the Indian scenario, already we have very strong middle upper lateral cartilage and upper lateral cartilage and the strong mid vault. Sir, what is your opinion for the spreader graft?
Yes, you're right. I think... But yes, for sporadograft is indication is mainly for two reasons. One is for your aesthetic, other is for functional reasons.
Yes,
and it's very important to reconstruct the mid dorsum area. Otherwise, your patient postoperatively, not immediately after 3 or 6 months later, patient says, I cannot breathe, because the reason is your internal nasal valve has collapsed. And so this is what Sunil is showing now. It is the placement of sporadograft. It is just a 5 minutes job. I think this has to be the most important part of the functional aspects of the surgery. So one should pay attention to the reconstruction of the mid-dorsal wall, and the sporadograft, to my mind, is the most key aspect of the surgical reconstruction.
Yes, sir. So,
this is important.
Whenever we use the sporadograft, the first important thing, first you know what is the exact site of the sporadograft and the length of the sporadograft. Whenever we use the sporadograft in the mucoperichondrial pocket, then ideally the length of the this sporadograft, that is around the 15 millimeter to 25 millimeter, and the width, that is around the 2 to 2.5 millimeter. So we first put the sporadograft, and the ideally the length of the sporadograft from the distal part of this nasal bone to the anterior septal angle area. And according to the need, either use the unilateral or the bilateral sporadograft. It's depend on the case to case. Sometimes your mid vault is concave, then in that case, you need a bigger sporadograft on the concave side, and the usual another on the convex side. So once you put this sporadograft, then first you fix the three structure or the five structures. It's your priority. Then you pass a needle from one side to the another side. Either you can fix first the three structure, first the septum and both of the spreader, and you use for fixation is a horizontal transverse suture.
In fact, Sunil, you on one side, if you can do it, I think surgeon at this point has got option whether you want to use a spreader flap or spreader graft. I think
yes,
on the
sir.
Right side, you can show the spreader flap on one side in which you feel comfortable putting a spreader flap.
Sir, how frequently you use this spreader graft?
Most frequently, I use, I think, more than 95-98% of cases spreader graft or spreader flap. So, I don't know what Dr. Kapil feels.
But in the Middle East nose, sir...
It's the spreader flaps only in cases where we do the reduction. So, we have longer upper laterals. Then only we can do the spreader flaps. Okay. But the rest of the cases, you have to do the spreader graft only.
Yes.
Nikal gaya? Tooth force dena mere ko. Give me the 4-0.
Neil, first fix with your 25 number needle. Spread it on both sides.
Yeah, that is the good method.
Because it will help you to
procedure. Yeah.
Providing a stability. And you can put filter easily.
Needle. Yeah, once we fix at the anterior and the posterior, that is good.
Yes. All five segments. No, your right spreader graft did not come.
Give me the.
You can put a little higher up as well. Yeah.
Needle. Give me the needle. Good. I fixed the needle. This cadaver cartilage is so fragile.
I know, little fragile. Yes.
So that is the little bit tricky.
Yeah, I know. You are doing a wonderful job. Good. Yes. and then you can now. Excellent.
Give me the. Sometimes in the rhinoplasty, like whenever you separate in the anterior septal angle area and whenever you fix the your spreader graft, then that little bit tricky, sir, really. But you don't lose your patience. So you can, I think, it's my...
No, you can take a little deeper bite.
Yes, sir. So I think if you fix the three structure, that is the easy first.
Yes, yes.
That is the easy.
I think we should just keep it things simple.
Yeah. And another important thing in India, sir, we don't have this straight needle. I think I don't find any company. If you have a straight needle, then that is good to fix this spreader graft. We have this curved needle. So
I thought Ethicon has got the straight needle. No, what about Ethicon?
I am not fine, sir. If there we have the straight needle, then that is good for the fixation.
They are available, but not in India.
Oh, I see.
I think not in India, nahi, Kapil was? Cut it.
Yeah, I never got them.
Yeah, that's the same. No, even, otherwise, it's a very easy.
No, even in Middle East, we don't get that straight needle. We try to get it many times, but...
So, sometimes we this needle, we straight like this one.
Yeah.
Because in India, we have the option of everything.
Jugaad.
Jugaad, sir. So, we need only two or three sutures for the fixation of this spreader.
I think your cephalic end of the right spreader graft not come. You have to go a little...
So this is the fixation of the cut it spreader graft. Now, once you fix by two or three horizontal matres suture, that is enough. So we discuss about this spreader graft, the indication of the spreader graft, ideal length of the spreader graft. So sometimes when we need the more stable tip, then the length of the spreader graft extend till the medial crest and till the strut or the till the septal extension graft, that is the extended spreader graft. Sometimes in a when we augment a binder case and crooked nose, then we use the extended spreader graft. So give me the seizure. So ye nikal le, ye kaam aa jayenge fir apne. So this is about the spreader graft, and now another form of the spreader graft, that is the auto spreader flap. So in auto spreader flap, we use the axis part of this upper lateral. Sometimes if your patient is have a hump, then in that case you can use this upper lateral cartilage, axis upper lateral cartilage, as a spreader graft. So whenever you use the auto spreader flap, then first you separate the mucopericondium around the 1 centimeter from this upper lateral cartilage laterally.
So in every hump you can...
No, not in every hump. Suppose you want to reduce the mid vault width, or you don't have the cartilage for the spreader graft and you have excess upper lateral cartilage, then you can rotate it and suture and use as a spreader flap. So give me the cartilage holding. So one more. So in that case, whenever you use the auto spreader flap, then you like hold this one after the separate this pericondrium and you rotate this according to the needed amount and you suture it like this one. So give me the suture. ये इधर से आएगा, ये ऐसे लगाओ इसको. So basically this auto spreader flap, that is the another form of the spreader graft. hold it. Sir, whenever you use the spreader flap, then your note is either the medially or laterally. Sir?
Laterally.
Yeah, you're asking me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, it should be medially, inside, not outside.
Yeah, it should be medially, yeah. It should be medially.
The reason is, why I'm saying reason is, if you keep your note outside,
yeah,
the patient has a very thin skin and you have used non-absorbable sutures that is visible as an irregularity on the mid dorsum.
Cut it.
So it should be on the inside.
Yes, that should be. So it's
not always message. Should be inside, should be buried.
Yeah. So we start the suture from the inside. So this is the auto spreader flap. So according to use, according to the need, according to the modification of the mid vault, we can use the auto spreader flap. Now, another important thing, seizure, give me the seizure. We use sometimes the flaring suture for the modification of the mid vault. Flaring sutures is basically a spanning sutures for the increased cross-sectional area of the lateral nasal wall, internal nasal wall. So, in flaring sutures is a basically horizontal matrix suture. So, in flaring suture, how you put the flaring sutures like this in the one side of the upper lateral cartilage to the another side of the upper lateral cartilage. So this is the another form of the increase the cross-sectional. So when you pull it, look that when you pull it, then you open your upper lateral cartilage. So this is the type of the spanning suture, horizontal matrix suture, then you can use just for increase, you correct your internal nasal wall insufficiency. So we suture this. So these all about the mid vault modifications. Now after the mid vault modifications, we move on the lower vault, the tip vault modifications. So really the tip is really also a challenging because to get the predictable outcome, there is lot of things because tip have the endless anatomical variation. So you have to know about the tip anatomy, tip aesthetic analysis and the tip dynamics. So what is that? So the most important thing, first you know about the tip characteristics, then if you know the tip characteristic, then you judge the abnormality of the tip deformities and the tip problems. So there are five tip characteristics that you have to know when you do the tip surgery. So the first, that is the volume of the tip. The volume of the tip, that means the size of this lateral crust. This is the lateral crust. So the size of this lateral crust, that indicate the volume of the tip. So if you want, if your patient have problem and if your patient complained then regarding the size of the tip, then you deal with part of this lateral crust. So volume of the tip, that is the size of the lateral crust. And another important thing, second step of the tip characteristic, that is the width of the tip. So width of the tip, that the distance between this dome area. So the dome area, ideally the distance between the dome area, that is the 6 to 8 millimeter in the female patient, but in the male patient, it is around 8 to 10 millimeter. If more than this, the patient have, then you have the broad tip. So this is the second tip characteristics, that is the width of the tip. And the third tip characteristics, that is the definition of the tip. So the definition of the tip, that is the angulation of this dome, amplitude of this dome, that is important, that is the tip characteristics. And fourth important thing, that is the projection of the tip. So projection of the tip, that projection is the distance. So by which the nose project from this face. So from this ala facial groove to the tip defining point, this distance is the projection of the tip. So the projection of the tip, that is around the two-third the length of the central central length of the nose, because the nose have the three length. One is the central length and two is the lateral length. In the central length from the nasion to the tip defining point, and the lateral length from the nasion to the ala margins. So the projection, there is a different method to analysis of the projections, but it's a grossly, ideally, that is the two-third of the length of the dorsum. And fifth, that is the rotation. So the rotation is the tip angle. That means the angle either the nose cephalically and the caudal from this ala facial groove to the tip defining point. So this usually we measure in the nasolabial angle, that is usually around the 90 to the 95, that is in the male patient, and in the female patient that is 95 to 115, that is indicate that in usually in the female patient that we like the obtuse nasolabial angle, but in the male patient that is the acute nasolabial angle. So you have to know that when you do the rhinoplasty, the characteristics, either the masculine features or the feminizing features. And the last is the shape of the tip. After the volume of the tip, the definition of the tip, width of the tip, projection and rotation, the shape of the tip. So the shape of the tip is the three types. One is the broad tip. Broad tip, that means we have the more interdomal distance, 6 or 8 millimeter. And another is the boxy tip. So what is the boxy tip? When your angle of the dome divergence, the angle of the dome divergence is the more than 30 degree, and amplitude of your dome is more than, I think, less than this 4 mm, then you have a boxy tip. And another important thing is the bulbous tip. We use it word the bulbous tip. The bulbous tip, that means the index between the interdomal distance and this ala base width is the more than 0.6, then that is the bulbous tip. So in rhinoplasty surgery, we use so many terms, but you know what exactly meaning of that term, so you can better judge your patient deformity. So for after the all five these tip characteristics, 95% tip deformity you can correct by the five tip techniques. Usually in all primary cases, 95% tip you can correct by the five tip technique. So what the five tip technique, we discuss one by one. The first technique that we use, the columella strut. So whenever you use the any technique, then you always remember first, you know, what is the purpose of this technique and what is the indication of this technique. So when whenever you use the columella strut, then the purpose of the columella strut, we get a unified tip and we get a symmetrical tip, because the purpose of the columella strut, that is the, we need the stable tip, we need the projection, and we need the shape of columella, good shape of the columella. So the ideal length of the columella strut part, so this is the ideal length of the columella strut. So my strut is around the 20 millimeter long and 2.5 mm width and 1.5 mm the thickness of my strut. That is ideally strut for the... So you have to know about the length, width and the thickness for your strut, and the warmer part of the cartilage, that is the ideally part for the your columella strut, because the thickness is good according to for your strut. So the technique, how you use this strut, so there is three step by which you can fix this strut. In the first step, you can make the ideal shaping. So we can make the ideal shape of the columella strut. And the second step, in second step, you make a groove. And how you make a groove is very important. Then you hold with cartilage holding. You hold this both domes by this cartilage holding forceps and give the counter tractions, and you just take a sharp scissors and you just make a hole on this anti-nasal spine area. And it's an important thing when you make the groove on the anterior nasal spine area, then you left some little bit amount of the tissue on the anterior nasal spine. Otherwise, post-operative, your patient complained that is clicking of the tip. So when you left some amount of the tissue, then on the anterior nasal spine is the better. The patient have not complained like the clicking of the tip. So you make the ideally this groove on this area, and then where is your stretch? For beginners, it's a good method. Then if you can identify, then how much you go inside of this strut marker, Dena. Then you can mark in the mid part of the strut. You can mark in the mid part of this strut. You can mark in the mid part of the strut. And wherever you insert this strut in the earlier, when you start your rhinoplasty career, then when you insert this strut in this groove, then you insert at the level of the your marking. So your pocket should be adequate. So ideally you should lay till the end of this ones. And once you fix it, then for fixation of the your strut, then You hold your dome and rotate it 90 degree. And then give me needle. You pass a needle from one side. Strut ko pakadna. To the another side. And the important thing, when you pass the needle one side to the other side, that your needle should be straight. When I pass this needle, this is the wrong method. So ideally the right method, the needle should be on the same plane on the one side to the another side in the straight manner. Your needle should be straight like this. Otherwise, your tip is, when you fix your tip, then your tip have like the deformity. So now after the first part, the shaping, and the second part, the insertion, and third part, the fixation of the strut. So when you fix your strut, and you can use the 50 PDS sutures, because it's also important thing that which type of the suture you used. When you fix your spreader, then you use the 40 PDS suture, because in that you need the strong, strong suture. And when you fix your strut, then you use the 50 PDS. So you pass your needle, hold position karna, from one side to the another side. Cartilage holding chahiye mere ko. Ye dena hai. Haan. So in the ideally, where actually you use the first suture, this is also important. So your first suture should be at the columellar break point and the junction of the infratip lobule and the columellar part. So another important thing, whenever for fixation of your strut, then entry of your suture, entry of your needle and exit, that is on the same plane. I think my voice is not. So the end. So then another important thing, the note. So whenever you use the note, then you can use either the from the skin to skin or through the inside of the in the subcutaneous. I think the better habit that you use the subcutaneous, so that you're not in the columellar flap. Sir, what is your opinion for that? When you fixation, then your knot is the subcutaneous side or outside, sir?
Subcutaneous.
Midline.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Midline.
So you use for three sutures?
You come from this? You come from in and in out. First you take from in, then you come out. So your Lord will be in the middle.
Yes, sir.
You are suturing from the outside. So the knot will remain out.
Yeah. So according to you that your knot is inside, na?
Yes, yes. You start from inside first, come out, then again you go in and then come in the mid.
Exactly. Boss.
Near the septum. So it will remain in the midline.
Yeah. So once you fix your strut, you also fix this strut by the third on this one. And ideally, once you use the two or three, then you fix your strut. So by this columella strut, I think you 95% in rhinoplasty, you can correct your this projections part. You never jump on the septal extension graft. You can use the septal extension graft or other technique for the 5%. And once you are more confident about the, because the septal extension graft have the versatile properties, because the projection by the septal extension graft, then with the projection you have the other changes also, like the rotation also, because according to the tripod concept of the tip, according to the Anderson, this tip have the three legs, the one central leg that is the medial crest and the caudal septum, and the two leg of the tripod that is the both side of the lateral crest. So once you change one leg of the according to the tripod, then automatically change two other leg. So septal extension graft when you use, that is very versatile. Definitely you can use once you are the confident about the graft and when you do the so many cases. Now after the strut, the second important technique, that is the dome sutures. So for the modification of the tip, we can use the two types of the dome suture. One is the intradomal suture and other is the interdomal suture. So first I use the intradomal suture. So by the intradomal suture, we can increase the angulation of the dome. We can getting the more definition of the dome. So whenever you use the intradomal suture, then the in intradomal suture, basically it's a horizontal matrix suture. So you pass this needle from the medial to lateral and around the 2 or 3 millimeter behind the margin of this, and you ask your assistant this one. So medial to lateral, and the knot of this dome creating suture or intradomal suture, that is the medially. So basically when we need the more angle increasing, then this is the your dome creating suture or intradomal suture. So you appreciate the difference when we use the dome creating sutures, then the angulation of the dome is increased. Cut it. Another the that is the interdomal suture. You never confuse between the interdomal suture and intradomal suture. Because interdomal suture, that means to connect the both of the dome, just like an intercity express. So you never confuse. And ये ऐसे लगा के देना. मेरे पास ऐसे नहीं. So for the interdomal suture, after once you finish the both of the intradomal suture, then for the interdomal suture, you have the two way. One way from this side to this side. This is the one way. And another important thing, another way by which you can fix, that is, first me make the interdomal suture. Isko pura inquire. First we finish this intradomal suture, then it's easy for the interdermal suture. Sir, which suture you usually use for the this derm sutures?
I use 40 PDS.
40 PDS, sir.
Yeah. Secondly, Sunil.
Sir.
For the delicate cartilages, if you can use non-tooth forceps for the audience, that will be better. So they should not get this wrong message that they should you use tooth forceps. They should be as traumatic as much. If you can use
Yes, really, it's an important thing, sir. So yeah. When you fix, this is your interdermal suture.
कहाँ पे लगा रहा है अभी
So by the interdermal suture, we can decrease the width of the tip. So this is the third maneuver technique by which we can modify the tip. And the fourth,
I think your columellar strut is not incorporated in the domes. I think if you can use one more suture slightly higher up.
Yeah, yeah, definitely.
For the columellar
strut, another important. Yeah. That if you like use a suture below this dome knot.
No, in this now try to no. Take from columellar strut. Don't take this bite.
Yeah. Sir, if you use in this manner, this is the another methods by which if you fix use the interdermal, then we can decrease like the interdermal distance and we also the infralobule tip width also. So this is the another methods of the interdermal sutures. Cut it. Sir, you add some.
Yeah, no. What Kapil was mentioning about, I think, the fixation of this columellar strut, the first suture is the key suture for centralizing and keeping the strut in the midline. So the suture has to come from inside out, outside in, outside again, go other side, then come inside. So knot comes in the center, in the middle. So your columellar strut will never shift to either side. It will remain in its midline.
Yes, sir. That's the important things. And after the dome sutures, the another important thing that by which we can change the size of the lateral crest, that is the cephalic trimming. So by the cephalic trimming, we can reduce the size of the lateral crest. So the important thing that it's not important how much you remove the cephalic, cephalic part of this lateral crest. The important thing that how much you preserve. In Indian patients, we have very thick skin. So in that case, I think because of the all Western literature that means 6 to 8 millimeter. But in Indian case, we can preserve the around the 8 to 10 millimeter. Sir, what is opinion for that?
Absolutely.
How much we preserve in Indian patients?
You are 100% right. It is preserved as much as possible.
Yes, sir.
The reason is we have a thick skin.
And yes, sir.
What you are concerned is not the short 1 year follow-up, 6 months follow-up. You are concerned about long-term follow-up. The patient after 10 years, 15 years should not get secondary ulnar collapse.
Measurement. Yes, sir. So according to basically just I the demonstration, the thing for the beginners, then first you measure how much basically you need around the 10 millimeter if you need, and then you excise the rest of amount for if you want to the reduce the size of the tip. Sometimes what happened in a thick skin patient, if you do the over excision of the lateral cusp for the narrowing of the tip, in that case the patient develop the ala collapse or patient develop the ala retractions. Truth for something.
What Kapil feels about it? Hi, Kapil.
I think they left, na? Huh? Hello?
Sorry, sir. I missed the question.
Yeah, I think what Sunil was asking, how much of your the cephalic trim in Indian patients you keep it?
Hardly any time I do.
Okay, you don't do that, true. Yeah. So you try to preserve as much as possible.
Yeah, I try to preserve that.
Yeah, I think that is the key, I think, message. Do not over resect. Huh? Because our patients are different from Caucasian patients.
Okay. Yes, yes.
Hello. Hello, Sandeep sir.
Most of the time we need actually lengthening of the nose, not the reduction.
True.
Hi, Dr. Sandeep sir.
Hi, how are you?
Hi, sir. Good evening.
Me?
So whenever you do for the cephalic trimming, then it's the important message, my junior colleagues. Then whenever you excise, then how much excise, that is not important. The important thing, how much preserve. And when we excise, then we reduce the volume of the tip. And another advantage of the cephalic trimming, that this lateral crust is more malleable after the excision for the suturing. So this is the purpose of the cephalic trimming. But sometimes if you need like the more strength of this cephalic and this lateral crust, then rather than we excise, we turn it after making incision, and we turn it and we flap and the suture again is. That is the lateral turn or flaps of the lateral crust.
Yeah, so it's also known as infolding technique.
Yes, sir. So we fold it. So we
we
increase the strength of the lateral crust.
Again, just you need to put just one or two sutures of 4 or 50 PDS, and you can just turn the knot inside.
Yes, sir. Exactly, sir.
Yeah.
And then after the all these five tip techniques like the columella stud, the dome sutures, and another like the cephalic trimming, another the important thing for rest of the 5% tip, we need some like other techniques like septal extension graft or the septal extension graft or the tongue in groove techniques. So when you're a patient that have then excessive columella show, ideally the columella show, that is the 2 to 4 millimeter, that is the columella show. And the columella show, that is due to the protruding of the caudal septum between the medial crust. So when this infratip lobule is excess, then the advancement of the caudal septum, advancement of the columella on this caudal septum, that is the tongue in groove. We both of this medial crust, we advance on this this caudal part of the septum, so that is the tongue in groove. And sometimes we use the spread septal extension graft, and after using the septal extension graft, we suture this medial crust on the caudal part of the septum, so that is the modified tongue in groove. So these all about the tip sutures and the tip techniques. Yeah, so after the all these five tip techniques, sometimes we need the more definition of the tip. So in that case, when we need the more definition of the tip, then we use the add-on tip graft. So In add-on tip graft, there is different type of the graft. You use the cap graft or the sealed graft. In a primary case, when we use the sealed graft, then for increased definition or the in the thick skin patient, for the definition, we use the sealed graft. वो जो cartilage है ना जो बड़ी निकाली थी अपन ने. So for the sealed graft, sir, how frequently use the add-on graft, sir?
Very frequently.
पर टाइम बताना क्या हो गया. व्हाट इज द टाइम, व्हाट इज द टाइम, अच्छा या I think this is a very fragile cartilage, na? It's very fragile cartilage. Give me that 15 number plates. So when you use the sealed graft after making the ideal shape, then you fix this sealed graft on this by a needle like this, and you fix the both shoulder of this tip graft by the dome area, and the tip graft, this sealed graft that is above the dome area, so for increase the definition of, and one suture of this sealed graft on this medial crust and on this medial crust, and another sutures on the dome area. So this is the sealed graft for increase the definition, especially in a thick skin patients or the revision cases. And in the last part of this tip modifications, the external nasal valve area, we sometimes after we usually neglect the external nasal valve area. In the external nasal valve area, basically depend on the this lateral crust pathology of the lateral crust. So this lateral crust sometimes have the other more deformities, like sometimes the lateral crust have some contour or orientation deformity. Ideally this lateral crust have convex, and this adjacent part of this dome area is concave. So sometimes this lateral crust is more concave. So that is the paradoxically curved lateral crust deformity. So the patient develop a depression on the LA area, that is the paradoxically curved lateral crust. So in that case, this lateral wall lost the support of this lateral crust. So the patient developed the ala collapse and the external nasal wall insufficiency. So in that case, if your patient have a paradoxically lateral crust, then you separate this entire lateral crust, and then we cut it from this dome area and then flip it. So that is the lateral graft flip technique for the paradoxically curved, for correction of the external nasal wall insufficiency. And another important thing, sometimes this lateral crust have a orientation deformity. In the orientation deformity, ideally the orientation of this lateral crust look that is the towards the lateral canthus at around the 45 degree angle from the midline. But sometimes this lateral crust have the orientation towards the medial canthus. So that is the cephalic malposition of the lateral crust or parenthesis deformity. So whenever you correct the parenthesis deformity, then we separate this entire lateral crust from the after the infiltration in the vestibular mucosa, and then we use the lateral crest strut. Ek baar wo dena koshish karte hain isme. Periosteum. We complete separate the seizure, then a fine seizure. In this side we can move. So we separate completely this lateral crest area. I just show you. It's cadaver, it's very difficult to separate the vestibular mucosa, but I just try.
You try from inferior, from caudal aspect. The vestibular mucosa is much easier for you to.
Yeah, yeah. So whenever you use, like, just for the knowledge, then give me the that means the. Yes, cut it and ek graft dena wo jo bada wala. So whenever we correct the parenthesis deformity, then we change the angle of the lateral crust. So when we change the angle of the lateral crust, then we use the lateral crest strut graft or the Ellabaton graft. So the lateral crest strut graft, we use both and the same purpose, but the lateral crest strut graft is better than Ellabaton graft, because lateral crest strut graft we fix like this one on the lateral crest for giving the new position of the lateral crest, and this end we suture by this 40 PDS, and another end on this the piriform at the outside of the piriform aperture. So we can fix this lateral crest in the new position. So this is the correction of the parenthesis deformity. But sometimes, if we rather than use the lateral crest graft, if we use the Ellabaton graft, then Ellabaton graft we suture on the just like only on the lateral end of the lateral crest. But in both of lateral crest graft is better, because we fix this lateral crest graft with underside of the lateral crest. So he pushes outside of the lateral crest, sir. What is your opinion in the both with Ellabaton and the lateral crest graft? Which one better, sir?
Yeah, see, now this is depend upon the deformity. If you are decided for lateral crest graft, especially sir, for it's a malpositioned lower lateral cartilage, then first of all, my steps would be I will infiltrate the vestibular mucosa, okay, sir. underneath. Then you have to elevate the vestibular mucosal flap underneath completely, right from lateral to middle direction up to dome, and maybe little part of the middle part as well. And then you have to refashion your cartilage graft, and ideally which is suitable for your graft. If you have sufficient septal cartilage graft, that's fine. If you don't have enough of septal cartilage, then best other choice would be conchal cartilage.
Yes, sir.
Use the conchal cartilage graft. And then the next important thing is that you have to make a pocket in the lateral piriform aperture region. And then you have to put a transfixes and suture from there. You have to bring that graft which you placed from there, suture. If you don't fix that suture, because that will define how much of your lateral crura it is coming to the alar margin. If you're not fixed properly, otherwise your lateral crura will remain in the mild position. So these are
sir, where exactly you fix the lateral part of lateral most yeah, part it is of in the mild crested graft.
Yeah, if you just show me the piriform aperture, if you
on can, outside of the piriform aperture or the inside of the
first, if you can elevate with your retractor the piriform aperture from this flap, which you have already elevated.
Yes, sir.
On the left side.
Yes, sir.
Left side.
So really, it's an important message. When you fix the lateral most end of your lateral crest graft, then you fix on the outside of the piriform aperture.
In either side, just retract your this soft tissue from the lateral lateral soft tissues.
Yes, sir. One last that we use a technique on the deformity of the lateral crust, that is the lateral crura overlay. Sometimes when we want to decrease the shape, decrease the size of the lateral crust, then rather than the cephalic trimming, we use the lateral crura overlay. So in the lateral crura overlay, we just cut this lateral crura around the 8 millimeter lateral to this dome area, and then after cut the lateral crura, we overlap it. We overlap it around the 5 millimeter. So we increase the strength of this lateral crust and decrease the volume of the tip. Whenever we use the lateral crura overlay, then it basically decrease the projection and increase the rotation. So whenever you use the any technique in rhinoplasty, then once you confirm about the each and every aspect of the technique, then you should use, never jump on the basically on the advanced technique. So I think these all about the tip techniques. Sir, from my side, I think I just cover the each and every aspect. You want add on anything, another some tip for the, or especially or the junior colleagues for the when they start the rhinoplasty?
Sunil, you've done excellent job. You've covered all aspects of rhinoplasty.
Thank you, sir.
You did a very excellent demonstration today. And all the key points you were very nicely explained in detail. And you have demonstrated the surgical steps, each and every step very minutely. And
I second your thoughts, Dr.
Isn't it? What is the couple your
because,
opinion?
Really, sir?
No, I second your opinion.
Whenever we go, I always ask to the junior colleagues, whenever go for the cadaver dissection, that each and every aspect they try to, because we respect the cadaver, and each try to just pick up the each and everything, never the cut the cadaver and do the finish the cadaver dissection. So they just try to learn each and every aspect of the during the cadaver dissections.
No, very, very excellent your demonstration you have done today. I think all the key, the keen learners will get a lot of confidence in knowing the basic structures, they're dealing with.
They focus the camera on the fellow. Sir, we have with us the 6 fellows from the different part of the or the countries, the plastic surgeons and the ENT surgeons for they already doing the good job of the rhinoplasty, all of from the Ludhiana. And Dr. Sabha, where are you from? Huh? Yeah, ma'am, from you on that. And doctor? So next 5 days, we just we improve more and more and learning more and more. And send thank you for the joining and giving your precious time.
I think your participant will cherish, and all those who are watching your cadaver dissection today, I think they will really appreciate you have explained.
Thank you. Thank you, sir, for appreciating my job.
Really
thank you, Kapil Bose.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Sunil. Everything's thoroughly very nice. Good, very good job.
Thank you. Once again, I thank you to Dr.
Sudhir
Bhandari.
Thank you for inviting us and be a moderator of this. Thank you very much.
Just I try to do my best, then cover each and every, but learning is never ended. The discussion is the endless, but we have bind with the times and there are so many things. And I again thank you to Dr. Sudhir Bhandari sir, Dr. Dheeraj Saxena, because without they provide this cadaver, and without cadaver, I think we cannot do. So thank you the Sun Pharma, because they always ready whenever we do for the academic event. And thank you Pradeep Goyal sir, they always ready for me whenever I they ready always for me, and they guide me. Thank you. So
you have an excellent team. It's great to know all this.
Thank you, sir. So, okay. Thank you, sir. We finish.
Bye. Bye.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. All the best.
Yeah. Bye, Dr. Amar. See you in the
bye, Kapil. Yeah. Looking forward to see you, Kapil.
Next week, yeah.
Looking we'll forward meet. To see you, Kapil.
Yes, yes.
How are you doing?
I'm fine, sir. How are you, sir?
Yeah, good. I'm just trying to now trying to get settled down in Delhi life.
Yes, see you on Friday.
Yeah, inshallah.
Bad luck today. We couldn't join the Sandeep sir because they are in Maldives. So there is the connectivity problems. So
okay. For a few moments he came on the line. Then again it switched off.
But they messaged me that I couldn't join because due to the net problem. Then on the beach area in the resort. Okay. So that is Wi-Fi problem there.
Okay. Convey our regards. Convey our regards to Sandeep.
Yes, sir.
Convey our regards. Yeah.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Right.